the newly launched Art Institute of Art Studies at Mary Immaculate College. So the title there is just really I'm talking about, thinking out loud as to what I do, which is as a musicologist, I have an interest in music in 19th century Ireland. And I'm just thinking about the whole issue of Irish studies and how musicology might articulate with that. But I'm doing this in a very kind of casual way, if you like. And what I have here behind me, just to, not selling these as such, but this is the Encyclopedia of Music in Ireland, in two volumes, which is, I think is going to enjoy its American launch tomorrow or Wednesday in New York. And then these are the moment 11 volumes of the Irish Musical Studies series, which I'll speak about in a while. But the series will continue on in the future, so it's an ongoing project. So, two things that concern me really as a musicologist, and it really has to do with perceptions of music in Ireland. Ireland is almost entirely absent from general surveys of music history by international musicologists. So, for example, most recently, Richard Turruskin's six-volume magisterial publication. Ireland is hardly present, but that's nothing unusual because textbooks, for example, going back decades, Ireland is, if you go look in notes or wherever else, you'll see perhaps a reference to John Field, who might be typically referred to as English or British, which is not terribly problematic in and of itself. But there would be scant reference. I suppose Thomas Moore would get a mention. Stanford might get a mention, but he's usually British. So if you go looking for Ireland in standard textbooks, it's not really there in any substantive way. And then secondly, music is almost entirely absent from cultural political studies of Ireland by Irish scholars. And again, you know, there's a good reason for that, access to archives and the whole issue of music as, if you like, a language in itself and so on. So these are two issues that really, you know, I suppose are at the forefront of my mind as I engage in research. So something to bear in mind as we go through this. So I want to think about what is musicology, and just very casually said three answers in the Grove Dictionary of Music and Musicians. At its simplest, it's the scholarly study of music. Leo Treitler, 1995, gives this definition. Traditionally, musicology has borrowed from art history for its historiographic paradigms and from literary studies for its paleographic and philological principles. So the emphasis here really is on this idea of art history and its historical discipline. So the idea of music as art. Again, in the Grove Dictionary, but here's the Grove Dictionary quoting from the American Musicological Society in 1955. A field of knowledge having as its object the investigation of the art of music, there's the word art again, as a physical, psychological, aesthetic, and cultural phenomenon. Okay, so very descriptive and straightforward. And again, the Grove Dictionary gives a more pluralist definition. The advanced study of music, is this the word scholarly replaced by the word advanced, should be centred not just on music, but also on musicians acting within a social and cultural environment. So this is a very important shift, as it says here, from music as a product, as a work of art, as an object, to music as a process involving composers, performers, listeners. I would expand that, look at impresarios, the whole music business and what have you. And it has involved new methods as well. Some of them borrowed from the social sciences, anthropology, ethnology, linguistics, sociology, and more recently politics, gender studies, and cultural theory. So it's quite a broadening out of the field of investigation in terms of its methodology as well as its objects of study. I suppose this word pluralist here is quite important. Continues on, the very next sentence is, this type of inquiry, which is exactly what we just looked at there, is also associated with ethnomusicology. And Frank Llewellyn Harrison, an Irish, very influential Irish ethnomusicologist, in 1963, and other ethnomusicologists have suggested, it is the function of all musicology to be ethnomusicology. That is, to take its range of research to include material that is termed sociological. So that's a profound profound shift away from the idea of music as an art. And all the time I'm thinking, how does that impinge upon the study of music in Ireland in general, but also particularly in the 19th century? Because it's if you take, you know, wherever you kind of, nail your colours to the mast, really affects everything, your methodologies and how you think about it. So, tentative conclusion, it is this multidisciplinary approach that best suits the study of music in Ireland, certainly to my mind. A reliance on the principles of art history with its focus on works of art would be unsustainable and in some cases irrelevant. And I suppose one of the problems with music in 19th century Ireland is largely the absence of what we would call works of art. And what we think is a work of art, I suppose, is predicated largely on, if you like, a Germanic model of great works of art by great composers. And we have the whole idea of a canon of great works. And if you go looking for that in the 19th century, you would be looking for a long time. But that's not to say they're not there, that there aren't works there. But the idea of greatness and so on becomes a very difficult historiographic principle on which to base your methodology, certainly in the 19th century. I suppose one of the problems around this is that if you go looking for a great Irish composer in the 19th century and you go looking for great Irish writers, you'll easily list off Irish writers who have difficulty looking for composers. One interesting case, of course, is John Field, who leaves Ireland at the age of 9 or 10, goes to London, is apprenticed there as in Clementi's warehouse, and then he travels with Clementi across Europe, and basically Field bases himself in Russia, ultimately, and establishes a European-wide reputation as a composer and also as a pianist, and influences people like Chopin, but also Liszt and others. And Liszt edits John Field's Nocturnes in a collection, and he writes the most romantic introduction to them, high praise indeed coming from someone like Liszt. And he basically says, you know, Liszt is not given to publishing his own works. He sort of writes them and these fallen leaves are left lying around, but Liszt wants to bring them together. And almost in a canonic sense, Liszt wants to say this is a canon of piano music, and writes about it in such a way. The thing, of course, is that Field never comes back to Ireland. He tours Europe at various times, comes back to England, but he never comes back to Ireland. He's largely unperformed in Ireland right up until the end of the 19th century. And when he is then performed and there's more awareness, people ask the question, because of the Gaelic revival and the Irish revival and what have you, what kind of Irish composer is this? One who didn't write ostensibly Irish music, one who didn't base himself in Ireland, and one who didn't come back. So Field is a very interesting problem for historiography of 19th century music. In a sense, Field did have a chance to come to Ireland at one point. Around 1834, he was back in England and performing a piano concerto with Sir George Smart. Now, Sir George Smart was a very important conductor and impresario of the early 19th century. And he got his knighthood from Ireland, from the Lord Lieutenant in Ireland. I think he paid £200 for it at the time. And this knighthood was very important for George Smart's development in England. And Smart came to Ireland many times. For example, 1831, he conducted when Paganini came. So there was Smart and John Field in London. So there's an opportunity, if you like, for him to come to Ireland. I don't know if they discussed it or not. It's kind of beside the point. The point is he was not too far away, and every other visiting virtuoso came to Ireland. Moscheles, Hertz, Kalkbrenner, Paganini, Liszt, Thalberg, Moscheles, Paderewski, Busoni, Charles Halle, and so on. But John Field didn't. He's the one name that stands out as being an exception in this regard. So he's the fly in the ointment. So I want to think now about Irish studies and what is Irish studies, and I'm saying it's singular rather than plural, put it in inverted commas here. I hope you can read it. I'll read a few. So the view from NUI Galway, and I'm literally taking this off their websites. So Irish Studies is an integrated interdisciplinary program of learning which seeks to explore key aspects of the Irish experience in its historical and contemporary settings. And in NUI Galway, the Centre for Irish Studies, music is a central element of the centre there in terms of the publications of its faculty. It's a core subject of study, and their artist in residence is a Shannó singer. So music is very much part of Irish studies there in NUI Galway. I'm just going to kind of go around the country and see other institutes. So a very important centre for Irish studies. Kilnaughton promotes research in all aspects of Irish studies. We facilitate the examination of cultural, political, musical, religious, economic, historical, anthropological dimensions of Ireland and its people. So there's music specifically referenced there. So another answer to the question, Trinity College Dublin. An exciting interdisciplinary, so it's not the first time we see this word, interdisciplinary programme devised by the English Department, History Department, Irish Department, in collaboration with Geography, History of Art and Film and Drama. So truly interdisciplinary there. Music itself is not specifically mentioned, but I'm sure it's not anathema to what the vision of Irish studies is. UCC, and we have a different kind of Irish studies, a direct quotation from the website. Ongoing emigration in the modern era has ensured that Irish cultures and identities, and of course the culture is plural, identity is plural, are a dynamic global phenomenon. The programme draws on an unparalleled range of disciplinary perspectives, so it's unparalleled in its scope. Within a strong framework of relevant theories and methodologies. Again, the plural here is very important. The result is a distinctive, compelling intellectual experience. So we'll get the sense here of some maybe marketing taking place because Irish studies is very much a very popular, I suppose, plank in any third level institution these days. And the institutions are competing with each other openly on the market. So we'll find this type of language. UL, a time for new thinking. So again, this is a particular MA programme. It will address current issues in Ireland and the diaspora, with particular attention to social theory, performance, performativity, historical depth and aesthetic nuance. Students will learn not only to identify and analyse, but also to question received narratives of culture, society, arts, history, politics, law and languages. Music isn't specifically mentioned there, but again, I imagine very much part of what it is. This, I suppose, performance and performativity here suggests the arts. I think, I'm not entirely certain, but performance, I presume, has to do with the execution and interpretation of, a piece of art, be it dance, a poem, a piece of music. Performativity, I think, has to do with negotiating issues of identity, really, in public and private spaces. So it's not necessarily about performance. So that they can often be confused, but I presume that's what's going on here. So it's very much a postmodernist take, and very much expanding the whole idea, if it is about gender and so on, and for example, the idea that sex and gender might be coterminous is not necessarily the case, whereas one is biological, the other is a matter of identity and negotiating that identity. And as Ireland changes rapidly, I suppose this is a very important issue. Again, another answer to the question. Irish Studies, Aiche, in case it's too faint, what is Irish Studies? Aiche is a journal of Irish Studies. It's devoted to the cultivation of a wide range of research, specifically Irish language and literature. So this is very much a definite focus. It includes important contributions of grammar, lexicography, paleography, metrics, the history of Irish language, as well as literary topics. Special emphasis in all aspects of the study of the language and literature of modern Irish. Okay, so very specific remit there. And if you were to look at the website of the International Association for Irish Literature, you will see things, I tell you, there are Franco-Irish studies and Irish-British studies and Nordic-Irish studies, Studios Irlandaises, which is a journal. In Asia, in Shanghai and Beijing, there are centres for Irish studies. Southern Hemisphere, here in New Zealand and so on, North South America, and it is a global academic activity. I was particularly interested in this from Nordic Irish Studies, which is a journal with many years publication behind it. It's published quality research done by literature specialists, historians, social scientists, political scientists, musicologists, first time I've seen the word, and geographers, as well as scholars from other disciplines included in the field of Irish studies. So, conclusion number two that I came to, Irish studies is centrally preoccupied with literature, social, cultural, political events and trends. Music generally means Irish music, which generally means traditional Irish music, when it is included. Other musical practices and traditions are largely unrepresented. Popular music, for example. Sacred music, what we might call classical music, which is essentially what I am concerned in my publications here, is what we might call classical music, which has other terms. For example, Western art music, or European art music, and all these terms are loaded because art then can have implications and almost value judgments built into it. So it is a contested area as to what to call, what we might call classical music. But largely speaking, Irish studies does not, and that's fair enough, that's not the way it developed, does not include it. So I want to think now about musicology in Ireland, and it's essentially where I'm coming from. And I'm going to just look at some professional associations. 1987 to 2003, the Royal Musical Association, its Irish chapter, was, I suppose, the predominant professional organisation for musicologists in Ireland. And Hilary Bracefield was very important in the development of that the Irish chapter. I started college in 1986 and only became aware of it really as a postgraduate student. But the Irish chapter meetings held every year would be alternate between the North and South. So for example, when I was in UCC, there would be a gathering, I suppose no more than this would be typical size, and people would come up and give a paper and sit down. It was all very personable and collegial, and I suppose very, very important for what happened next, which was the Society for Musicology in Ireland. But I mean, over this period there were 15 conferences, but very small, we might call them symposia nowadays or something smaller. But without this, we wouldn't have had a Society for Musicology in Ireland, I think it's fair to say, because over those 15 years, and I suppose other years as well, people got to know each other, share ideas, and the Society for Musicology in Ireland was established in 2003. Now, it's not as if there was a musicological 1916 and a revolution whereby the SMI gained its independence from the RMA, not at all. It's very much a very organic and natural process. And since then, 2003, there are annual plenary conferences and in more recent years, annual postgraduate conferences. And it should say they're very much of an international focus as well. And again, the location would be shared around the country. So I think 2006, Mary Immaculate College, we organised, I think what was a landmark conference. Gareth, Paul and myself were key organisers. And other colleagues and students at the time. And in 2009, I think, the RMA held its annual conference jointly with the SMI in Dublin, in the Royal Irish Academy of Music. And it was quite, I suppose, a leap of faith for the RMA to come to Ireland for that. But it was a wonderful occasion, a huge, huge event. And again, another landmark event, I think, in terms of its size and scope. Also very important is CHMHE, which is the Council for Heads of Music and Higher Education. And it sponsors an annual prize for undergraduate dissertations in musicology. And the winners are presented with their prize at the SMI Postgraduate Conference, and they read their paper at that. So there's some sort of overlap between undergraduate and postgraduate work and done under the aegis of the SMI and the Council of Heads. I suppose, since this is about me, I can sort of see myself in here overlapping. Since 2003, I've been on the Council of the SMI continuously and have served as a treasurer and membership secretary, secretary, webmaster and so on. So I've been keenly involved and with it, and I think it's very important, certainly for my work, in terms of networking and sharing ideas and so on. And here are the current 11 volumes. The first three were published by Irish Academic Press, but later volumes were published by Four Courts Press in association with the SMI. So, you know, these publications are essentially an outgrowth of that development. And the Encyclopedia of Music in Ireland would be, you know, I think the vast majority of contributors and editors were SMI members, nationally and internationally. And it's very much an international society in terms of its profile. just want to take a quotation here from Harry White, who wrote an article called Musicology in Ireland in 1988, published in Acta Musicologica, an international journal. So he's writing in 1988, and he says the Irish chapter of the RMA was less than a year old. There has never been an international musicology conference in Ireland. There was no scholarly forum for the dissemination of musicological research originating from within the island of Ireland. There had been little musicological research in any field other than Irish music before 1970. And he gives an exception to that, but generally speaking, that's accurate. And formal studies in musicology were almost non-existent, as in educational studies, certainly insofar as graduate programs in universities were concerned. So really, since about this time, things have profoundly changed. There's just no doubt about that. And it's very hard to see, but I'll just tell you. These are the affiliated members of the SMI, apart from the ordinary members and honorary members. Institutions can join as members. So Christchurch Cathedral, Dundalk Institute of Technology, Cork School of Music, Contemporary Music Centre, Trinity, UCD, UCC, the Irish National Committee for the International Council for Traditional Music, the Irish World Academy of Music and Dance, the Royal Irish Academy of Music, the Royal Musical Association, Queen's Belfast, and the Council of Heads, and so on. It's very strongly supported by national institutions. And again, the publications, this kind of brings me back here to what we have. The Encyclopedia of Music in Ireland, and I suppose here we're starting to think about Irish studies again in particular. Here's an encyclopedia devoted to music in Ireland. In every aspect, everything is there. Popular music, traditional music, what we might call classical music, music biographies, and what have you. It's been a long time in gestation, and has a very wide, huge contributor base and so on. Gareth Cox, myself, and Paul Collins were all involved in editing and also contributing, as were many other scholars, Gwen and so on, and Mary Isaac Hughes input on this. Irish Musical Studies, let's say volumes 1 to 3, were initially published by Academic Press, but then Four Courts, from volumes 4 to 11 and ongoing, are done by Four Courts. And the first volume was 1990, so again 1988, 1990, so this is a very important point. So Gareth, I think, edited volume 7 and most recently volume 11. I've done 9, I'm working on 12 at the moment. And the remit there, I suppose, is quite a broad base. It's not just on music in Ireland. For example, Gareth's most recent volume 11, Irish Music Analysis, is divided in two. The first half deals with the analysis of musical works by international composers, whereas the second half deals with the analysis of musical works by Irish composers. So again, it really, in a sense, reflects this broad base of the development of musicology. And the focus there, I suppose, on works predominantly is a very interesting one, showing that there are plenty of works to be analysed in Ireland, and is taken very seriously in 20th century, but it's not my area, but the development of PhDs, for example, and masters and so on, reflects that. The Journal of the Society for Musicology in Ireland, then, since 2005, the current editor is Gareth Cox, but the editor is, so it's kind of rotating editorship. And again, the list of contents there is very broad-based. It's not just devoted to Irish music, so I'll see if I can just put up the... So from 2005, so if we just pick volume 9, for example, this is a fully online journal, peer-reviewed, and again, an international contributorship. Wait, just want to see that. There could be anything from, looking at Schoenberg 20th century to medieval music to Irish music. It's a very, very broad. There's no particular Irish studies angle to it at all. What publishers publish studies of Irish music and music in Ireland? So Four Courts Press, apart from the IMS series, have books devoted to music in Ireland. Cork University Press, Ashgate has 6 recent titles on music in Ireland or Irish music. Oxford University Press, Boyd Dylan Brewer, and I should mention here as well the Field Day music series of biographies of Irish composers. And Gareth has a volume there on Saoirse Bodley. So there's quite an international, again, remit here with these publishers and so on. I want to briefly look at, if you like, some historical aspects to musicology in Ireland, but the musicology of music in Ireland. I can start there, I suppose, with Heinrich Beverunge, who was a German priest and became professor of sacred music in Maynooth. But apart from teaching basic harmony to young Catholic seminarians, he was also a scholar of international repute on sacred music. He turned his attention to traditional Irish music when he came here and engaged in, if you like, a historical musicology. William Henry Breton Flood, a direct contemporary of an Irish contemporary of Beverunge's, and they were colleagues, and in some senses Flood became his nemesis. He absolutely slated Beverunge when Beverunge could not return to Ireland, and he accused him of importing foreign organists when Ireland should be trying to promote its own tradition of sacred music. But ironically, Beverunge would have agreed with him. He wanted to establish this tradition of sacred music, but Beverunge, at the time of the First World War, could not return to Ireland. He was then had a professorship in UCD. And I think Flood has done a lot of damage to Beverunge's reception. But Flood is now known for his history, his volume History of Music in Ireland, which is famous for being deeply flawed, and almost a propaganda volume, but nevertheless you can't ignore it. Alex Fleischmann, so again, not unlike Beverunge coming from Germany, Fleischmann's father would have come, if you like, the same wave of foreign organists to Ireland for the same reason, along with Swiss and Belgian organists. And Fleischmann, apart from being a composer and broadcaster, also turned his attention to traditional music, a very influential publication there towards the end of his life, but also in 1952 publishes a book called Music in Ireland with many contributors examining the condition of music in Ireland. Ita Bosang, and this is if like the exception to Harry White's 1970 year, she publishes on early 19th century music in Ireland. And as a pupil of Fleischmann's, she was the first PhD in the country as a historical musicologist. And also publishes on music education and still does. And she's contributing to the next volume there in the series as well. One of the most active musicologists continuously over decades and decades in this country. Brian Boydell, again a household name earlier in the last century, along with Fleischmann as a composer and broadcaster. And again, towards the end of his career, turned his attention to the musicology of late 18th century Dublin. His son, Barra Boydell, joint editor with Harry White of the Encyclopedia, amongst many other things. This is apart from all their other publications, by the way, but Barra Boydell looks at Christchurch Cathedral, the Irish Harp, music education, and so on. Harry White, again, apart from his studies in German music, looking at nationalism, music literature, cultural history, Thomas More. Yeah, and Smachney, who's Hamilton Harty Professor of Music in Queens, writes on Harty. Axel Klein, a German musicologist. An independent scholar, not associated with a third level institution, but hugely influential, and it's fair to say one of the driving forces behind the Encyclopedia of Music in Ireland. And he's looked at so many aspects of art, music, tradition, classical music in Ireland that there's no point to even try to pinpoint one thing or another. He's most recently published a book on the O'Kelly family in France, for a Franco-Irish family with very influential in France in the 19th century. And then Jeremy Dibble, writing on Stanford and Esposito, for example. And Esposito, of course, is an Italian composer who comes to Ireland, lives in Ireland, very influential in the Royal Irish Academy of Music and so on. I suppose nowadays, looking at the days of the Irish Chapter meeting, the Irish Chapter of the RMA, we've got all these resources now available for musicologists. The Research Foundation for Music in Ireland, this is a website, Dublin Music Trade is a website, and of course so many things have been put online. The SMI Music Thesis Register, RILM Ireland, RISM Ireland, the National Archives of Irish Composers, which is a very interesting database being developed by the NLI, which has of course a huge repository of musical manuscripts from 18th, 19th century, and they're being digitised and put online, slowly but surely, but there are all sorts of issues around there. The Irish Traditional Music Archive, the Contemporary Music Centre, of course, which is really 20th century, but I've been included there. And I want to, I suppose, conclude with some recent activities in 19th century studies, which is my area. And there's one issue that recurs, I mean, there are many other issues, but I'm just going to look at one. That is, if you like, the recovery of forgotten or unknown works. And we're back to this idea of works of music by Irish composers or composers associated with Ireland. So just in recent years, Beethoven's Irish songs, for example, have been enjoyed a new edition and a CD released of them just only last year. John Field's concertos, for example, are now receiving quite a lot of detailed analysis from Professor Julian Horton, who was professor in UCD, now in Durham. And again, the whole idea of the Field problem, if you like, comes to bear here, because these concertos really are written without anything to do with Ireland at all, but they're now coming into like the musicological horizon. Paul Alladay, I suppose the search for an Irish symphony preoccupied people for a long time. People ask, where's our Irish baritone, where's our Irish Sibelius? And then the symphony by French composer Paul Alladay, who settled in Dublin, and the score and parts of a symphony were found and reconstituted and performed recently in DIT, but then also abroad. I suppose, not for French network in particular, but it's dangerous to go looking for the first of anything, because if there is not a continuous tradition, it's a bit of a non-starter. But I mean, it's quite legitimate to look for symphonies composed in Ireland. It's very much in the style of Haydn. People have said, well, it's not the first Irish symphony, because what's Irish about it? So you can run into all sorts of problems. Not surprising, it's written in the style of Haydn, of course, who was very popular in London, and London and Dublin are intimately connected. I should move on. Paganini, St. Patrick, these three in bold are because I am directly involved with them. So Paganini, St. Patrick's Day is a work that I often saw referred to in the newspapers. So Paganini, the great Italian virtuoso, comes to Dublin in 1831. And this year, 1831, is very important because this is the same European tour in which he profoundly influences people like Chopin and Liszt in Paris. But as a natural part of his tour was to come to Ireland, as was the case with all these virtuosi. Ireland was a normal part of the circuit. And he comes to Ireland and he arranges St. Patrick's Day, the jig tune. And that was a normal thing to do for these virtuosi. They would, whatever country they were in, they would pick a popular ballad or operatic aria or folk tune or whatever else and arrange it. And I saw it referenced many times and I wondered what he did with it. So I eventually tracked down the manuscript in a library in Rome, got the parts and put it together as a score. And at the moment I'm writing a script for a radio program for Lyric FM on visiting virtuosi. So it's all the people I mentioned before, Liszt and Moscheles and so on, and Paganini. And so this work will feature in the documentary as, if you like, a work. But it's not a work in the sense that we might think of a Beethoven symphony as a work, because St. Patrick's Day, for example, is written as a once-off. It's an ephemeral piece to please a Dublin audience, or when he went to Cork, the newspaper reviews are very laudatory and so on. So it's not a work in any sense. He never published it, unlike he published lots of other pieces of music, but this was left in Drury Lane, and because he arranged it again for the English King when he was in London, and the parts were forgotten about, and he probably saw no value, artistic or monetary, and was forgotten about. So I suppose part of what I'm doing is recovering these unforgotten and works in this sense. Moscheles, who comes to Dublin, and Una Hunt here has performed and edited his score of, he did what virtuosi did, was when they visited, they would leave and maybe publish something, Recollections of Ireland. So it's based on Irish tunes like Gary Owen and what have you. And again, it would have sold and been popular, so maybe Paganini missed a trick, maybe he didn't care. George Osborne, who of course is a Limerick composer and father was organist in St. Mary's Cathedral, George Alexander did not follow his father's footsteps to be organist in St. Mary's. He went abroad and settled in Paris, I think later in England. And was befriended Chopin and wrote in the Chopin style, a la Chopin. And he wrote this Fantasy in Irish Airs, which of course is features the everlasting Last Rose of Summer, because just about everybody put some sort of variation on the Last Rose of Summer. Michael William Balfe writes this Sinfonia, and of course the Italian name should alert us to the fact that there's nothing really Irish about it. He found himself, born in Dublin of course, but finds himself traveling across Europe, trying to make his way in the world, and he finds himself in Bologna and wants to ingratiate himself with the great and the good in the musical world, and that's basically Rossini, who dominated Italian opera at the time. So Michael Balfe writes the Sinfonia for Rossini's very wealthy friends in Bologna. And again, it's probably given one performance and the score is discarded and forgotten about. So thanks to Basil Walsh, I got my hands on the score and did a modern performing edition of it and performed it last year with the University of Limerick Orchestra. I'll come back to that in a second. William Vincent Wallace writes songs, and Laura Lane, these again have been re-edited and published in recent years again, thanks largely to Una Hunt and the National Library of Ireland. And in the course of a documentary I'm making at the moment on Ireland's national anthems, which is a look at all the anthems that Ireland had, God Save the King, A Nation Once Again, God Save Ireland, The Soldier's Song, Let Erin Remember, St. Patrick's Day, all these were possible anthems. Obviously Soldier's Song becomes the anthem of the Free State and later the Republic. But in the course of research for that programme, I come across Victor Herbert's piece, Soldiers of Erin. Victor Herbert was born in Dublin, educated in Germany as a virtuoso cellist, but settles in America and becomes the dominant composer of Broadway in the early 20th century. And in December of 1916, he publishes The Soldier's Song for Voice and Piano in New York and in Dublin. And Patrick Carney, of course, who writes the words of the anthem, is delighted with this. But Herbert also writes an orchestral arrangement of it, and he calls it Soldiers of Erin, the Song of the Irish Volunteers. And it's the first orchestral arrangement of what would become the Irish National Anthem. It predates by decades the orchestral arrangements by Narshe and Boyd Allen. And then, again, in the course of the research, I came across an English musician called Percy Beachfield Carver. And his family came to Ireland in the 19th century as circus musicians. And he finds himself the conductor of St. James's Brass and Reed Band, who were a band associated with the funerals of, I feel like, the most prominent Irish people, Parnell, the Manchester Martyrs and what have you. And they perform at Thomas Ashe's funeral in 1917, who died, wasn't executed by the British, but died subsequently in the following year. And Carver arranges the Soldier's Song. Again, this is before it's officially the national anthem. And again, these three works, editing these for performance, and thanks to the resources of the Mary Immaculate College Research Office, I was able to bring these to fruition. And then, at the moment, in the volume 12 of Irish Musical Studies, which is in progress here, Jeremy Dibble, for example, has uncovered more musical manuscripts by Michael Esposito. So, the thing about this profile here is one thing should strike us, and that's the international profile. You've got Irish composers and performers leaving the country and composing and performing abroad, and you also have Germans and Bohemians and whatever coming into the country and composing and leaving a trace there. So for me, one of the dominant themes of, you know, Irish music history in the 19th century is this international profile. It would be impossible to focus strictly on what you might call a particularly Irish type of composer or particularly Irish type of work. I would agree with this pluralist dimension to considering, you know, the to-ing and fro-ing of musicians. I'll very briefly give you a sample of, I suppose, what happens to these musical scores when they get edited. So this is just the end of this Michael William Balfe Sinfonia, which again, like the Poland Symphony, because it had the word symphony or symphony in it, people said, oh, this is the first Irish symphony, and there's always a competition to find the first Irish symphony, which to my mind is really not worth the effort, because I think there are other issues. So for me, this Sinfonia by Balfe is really about the history of music in Ireland, because it reflects the Italian style, and that tells us something about Balfe, an Irishman in Italy, just as Paganini's Patrick's Day tells us about an Italian in Ireland. I suppose I'll finish up by saying, is what I'm doing Irish studies? Well, I'm just going to assume it is until somebody tells me otherwise. Okay. Thank you very much indeed.
Thank you very much for a fascinating, I think,
overview, conspectus, more than a summary, more than a survey. I mean, really interesting. Discussion of music, Irish studies, and how they mix and meld and inform each other. Really, really interesting stuff. Questions, thoughts, comments? You left the most speechless.
I got one.
Right.
Thanks, Wynne and Michael. It was great just to see all the different, you know, the encapsulating musicology. I wondered though, Ashley Kenny's just published music, women and music in 19th century
yes,
Ireland.
Yes,
so
yeah.
Just, I don't know if
absolutely,
you
yes,
can
yeah.
tell us a bit about the women.
Yes,
so
yeah.
The men there.
Yeah, yeah, quite right, you're quite right. Ashley has contributed, Ashley Kenny?
Kenny.
Yes, yeah. And Jennifer O'Connor as well, I would include the two of them actually. Jennifer O'Connor has annually for quite a number of years had a music in women in music conference held in Dublin, and she's also contributed to radio programs I've done on female, like Annie Patterson, for example, who was so influential at this particular period again. And also contributing to the forthcoming volume there of Irish Musical Studies, again looking at the publications of not just Annie Patterson, but others at the time. So, I mean, that's very much a dominant trend as well, and quite right to point it out. I'm not familiar with Ashley Kenny's book at the moment, so...
I think it's in press. So.
Yes, yeah. I have no clairvoyant skills at all.
Yes. You mentioned earlier on that the Irish studies, where it tends to look at music, it's nearly always been traditional music, and that's something I think was... Jerry Smith said it in some German article a few
yeah.
years back. I think you'd more refer to popular music as opposed to classical music, that had been ignored in terms of Irish studies. Have you seen anything that's kind of indicating that there's been a change in that mentality, that it's moving away from just being about traditional music?
I haven't, which is not to say that it isn't there. I mean, it's so broad and international that I don't have my fingers in those pies.
Sure.
But I haven't seen it. But I can understand why Irish traditional music would be so popular and would articulate so closely with the general project of Irish studies thus far. Yeah, but I haven't seen any any change. But it's, I suppose I'm demonstrating that it's not impossible for it to happen. Should musicologists, I suppose, be aware of it or think of it and so on?
Anybody else?
This is just a general observation. I'd be interested to know what you think. I've been quite involved in the 18th century Ireland Society, and one of the things you see if you look at their journal, which started in 1986, was the first volume, and it was designed specifically as an interdisciplinary journal of 18th century Ireland, or Irish studies,
yes,
whatever you want to call it. In the early volumes, there's quite a lot of music, and it disappears. And in the early volumes, there's quite a lot of art as well, and it disappears too.
Yeah.
And I wonder, as Irish studies becomes more specialised, again, Irish musical studies, Irish history of art studies, and they're creating their own journals and structures, and it actually, as Irish studies gets bigger, it actually compartmentalises and fragments, in fact, so that even now if you go to an 18th century Ireland Society conference, you know, the literary scholars will sit in one room and the parallel people, the historians, will sit in another room, but we're talking to each other, you know, at dinner, openly, and then going our separate ways the next day again. So, you know, as this stuff becomes bigger and there's more scholarship, we become too specialised, perhaps.
Even, I think it's the Nordic Irish Studies Journal, they divide up the chapters into literature and society, and you'll find them even ghettoised within the volume list of contents itself.
That's a not fair great solution.
What's that?
I was waiting for your solution.
You're waiting for my solution, I see. No, I don't think there's any solution to this is exactly what's happening. Even with musicology is becoming so specialised itself. You know, there is no easy solution to it. I mean, there are some scholars, I think, who feel it is a dilution of their academic integrity to step outside the bounds of the discipline. It's a big problem, I think, perhaps maybe in North America and so on. Ireland, I think, has always had this more pluralist approach. I mean, Harry White has said this many times, and sees it as quite a healthy thing. But I mean, a very prominent musicologist in Ireland said to me that he really is not interested in kind of diversifying. He wants to stick to this particular canon of works that he's looking at and so on. And so I think there's an anxiety around it as well. Very hard to overcome that in terms of legitimacy and career track and so on.
I think discussions like this, where we have somebody who's an obvious expert on the area, but who's talking from within the area, but with a broader context in mind, might possibly be some way towards, you'll never counteract the specialisation, because we're academics, is what we do, we find a scene and we mine and mine and mine it. But to talk to each other, I mean, there was so much stuff in that I didn't know, which I found really interesting today, particularly about the national anthems and the various versions of it. Italians writing Irish music, Irish writing Italian, you know, that's the pluralism and the discussion that we're hoping to get going. And it's also interesting, I think, how central people in MIC in music, and I say MIC generally and not in either faculty, are so centrally involved in the publications of it, which I think is a marvellous thing for our students, because you're getting taught by people who are working at the cutting edge. They have deadlines too, the same as you do. But they come in on time, of course, they information.
All the time.
Okay, can I just thank Mike for, I know it would be good, but it's absolutely stimulating. Thank you, Mike, it's really, really good. And thank you all for coming. There are sandwiches there which you are welcome to take as you need.
Thank you.